Man, it's fucking hot, dude.
Team, welcome back to the Live Perform Compete podcast. In the studio today with Mr. Patrick James.
Hello.
Newest member of Team Coastal, Paddy.
I am, that's correct.
We are popping your podcast, Jerry, today.
Yeah, thank you.
How do you feel about it?
Very happy to be here. Thank you.
Good. We are here to talk about meditation, folks. I know both myself and Paddy, we both practiced meditation. We've had probably some very different stories with meditation in the past, have probably different reasons as to why we meditate. And so today's episode is about, I guess, firstly, sharing our stories of meditation. Why do we meditate and how we meditate? Perhaps talk about some of the benefits of meditation. I think there's a lot of stigma around meditation as well. People have some preconceived ideas. I certainly thought meditation was meant that I had to sit with my legs crossed and my middle finger and thumb in a circle position on my lap and
making humming noises. Yeah.
So yeah, I wasn't down for that for many years. And then, you know, if anyone at the end of this episode is then thinking about perhaps starting their own meditation practice or getting into meditation, maybe we can kind of advise people some places to start.
Yeah.
So, Paddy, I think we should start with a bit of definition as to what meditation is. I'm going to take us away here with my good friend Wikipedia, now open on my laptop,
cool.
Because we had a little conversation about what we would define in meditation. We both had a few points that we didn't have a very succinct way of putting it. But basically, meditation is a deliberate practice where an individual uses a technique such as mindfulness or focusing the mind on a particular object, thoughts, or activity to train attention and awareness and achieve a mentally clear and emotionally calm and stable state. What are your thoughts on that as a definition?
I'd say that's pretty wordy. I think that it essentially you want to be as present as you can with your thoughts, and there's many ways that you can do that. I think the easiest way to do that is by being very still in your body, which allows you to focus more on the clarity with your mind, being more present with your mind, taking away any movement of your body, just being very static, and that will then bring your focus into your thoughts and your mind.
What's your story? What's your journey of meditation been like? Why did you start meditating? How long have you been meditating for? Yeah.
So I think I first downloaded the Headspace app back in about 2018. Which is quite a while ago, and I first, like with any new habit, you get excited about it, and the first week or so, you're really into it, really, you want to tell anyone about it, and I got into a really good habit for about 5 or 6 days, and that was about it, and then dropped off for about 6 months, didn't do anything, picked it up for a couple of weeks again, tried it in the morning, tried it sometimes in the evening, and then would consistently keep picking it up for short periods of time and then dropping it. And it's only been in the last sort of year and a half that I've actually really committed to it and have seen a lot of the benefits mentally from it. And part of that was going off a little bit of a tangent, reading Atomic Habits and habit stacking something in the morning. With what I do already, adding a new habit or a new task that I want to achieve in the morning on top of that habit.
I'm gonna pause you there, Paddy.
Sure.
Because you're about to get something good, I know, but I need to backtrack you. Why did you even think to start Headspace? What was your catalyst to make you even start trying it? And for those of you who are listening who don't know what Headspace is, you may know because it's just come off Netflix. But basically Headspace was originally an app on the phone. It was probably the first like really popular meditation app by Andy, who is an English bloke who I believe was a monk
before. He's been a monk for a long time.
Yeah, has a very good way of bringing across the ideas of I guess kind of brought meditation to mainstream in a way. And essentially it was a guided meditation. So basically Andy is talking you through the meditation, you're listening to him and kind of following his steps. But I remember why I started first getting into Headspace, but what was your reason for getting into it?
I think actually it was purely from hearing about it, believing the hype of people saying how much value it added to their lives, a lot, sort of watch documentaries, sports documentaries, and I love learning about people's routines on a daily basis, whether that's athletes or coaches or whatever. And it kept coming up as a reoccurring theme of people practicing meditation in the morning before they would do anything. And they only spoke really highly of it. There was no one that was saying, oh, it's just a bit boring, it's like, it doesn't work for me. I think when people invest the time into it, actually really, they do see some benefits. So I just saw lots of people, it kept popping up, and I just kept seeing this app Headspace. And I'm quite a visual person. I liked the idea of, it has a lot of animations and a lot of cartoons on it. I just liked how there was something visual in it as well. And basically, yeah, just downloaded the app, started paying for the subscription, and that was it.
So you basically, in reading about other people's lives,
yeah,
everyone was talking about meditation and how impactful it was. And that was why you basically started getting into it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I mean, why I started getting into it, I remember because specifically we were at regionals in Australia. I think it was the first year of regionals in Australia, so that was 2015. Well, maybe 2016 was the first year I downloaded Headspace. Obviously stuck with the free app for at least a year before making a commitment to purchase. And I enrolled as a subscriber for about 2 years. But why I first came across Headspace was because of my sleep. And I talk about this quite a lot on the podcast, but you know, notoriously not a great sleeper. And basically ever since I started Coastal and running my business, it was basically the day that my sleep started to decline quite rapidly. And I think in 2015, what happened in 2016, sorry, you know, I just had my adrenals done. I just had my adrenals tested. Cortisol was extremely low, basically flatlined. Had been told by some experts that, you know, you need to really cut out amount of high intensity exercise you're doing, you need to sleep more, because I did a bit of a sleep analysis and I knew I wasn't sleeping well, but you know, like a lot of people, I'd made excuses as to why my inadequate sleep was actually adequate. But anyway, when I had the cold hard facts and I had my stats there in front of me, and you know, all my blood markers being really, really low, depleted for someone my age, I was like, okay, I think I need to start to do something about this. But obviously, as soon as you get told, if it's someone who's a bad sleeper, and I know you've had some bouts of bad sleep as well, when someone just says you need to sleep more, obviously it's not as easy as just...
Thanks, it's just like, you need to lose weight by being in a calorie deficit. Cool, thank you.
Yeah.
Like, what do I do now?
Exactly. And so it was like, all right, well, we'll try and get to bed early. That didn't work. You know, tried harder to sleep. And something I learned from Headspace was I started to create sleep anxiety, which is basically like this vicious cycle of being scared to go to sleep, because I knew I wasn't going to sleep. And then what was happening was I was going to bed every night and just worrying about whether I was going to sleep or not. And so rather than just allowing my brain and my body to naturally drift off into sleep, I was trying to force myself into a deep sleep, which obviously never works.
Yeah.
And I'm sure lots of people listening have probably been at that point at some point in their time.
It's very psychosomatic.
Yeah, for sure. And somehow, I don't know how I came across the Headspace app. I think I do remember one of our employees here at Coastal at the time had also discovered Headspace, and so it was really impactful for her. So that's when I first started. And I remember all the way through regionals that year, you know, we were sleeping in some really budget house in Australia, not an ideal sleeping conditions, but I got religiously into Headspace specifically before bedtime to help me sleep. So, you know, where you were using it as a morning practice because of the people that you inspired you, yeah, and told you to do it, I was actually doing the opposite, just using purely only for sleep. So where did that practice take you? So you started playing around with it, went on for a week, went off it, kind of came back to it.
Yeah.
Where did that journey then take you?
So like I said, probably for the last sort of year and a half, it's actually been a much larger part of my routines, both in the morning and now at bedtime as well. So it was more like a year when I really probably started having big long streaks of, you know, 30, 40 days at a time consistently, doing it at the same time every morning, and really being able to properly zone in on that and kind of forget where I was almost. And it, you know, after those sort of 30, 40 days in a row, I noticed a big difference in my awareness of my emotions and also just being more present in situations. So like today, in like 2021, it's so easy to get distracted by everything. There's so much stimulus, so many screens, everything's going left, right, center. You know, even something as simple as like sitting down and watching a movie, it's so easy to just inherently pick up your phone and start scrolling through Instagram, and you're like, what am I doing? I'm trying to watch this film. I've just missed the last 10 minutes. And just things like that, or things like going on a walk, or, you know, sitting down for a meal with someone, just all that, all the meditation side of things actually brought my focus into everything that I did, where it was like, right, let's focus on being completely present in this one moment where I'm with my friend having a meal, or I'm with my mum going for a walk, or whatever it is. And it had a snowball effect on everything else that I was doing, and I just felt much more zoned in and focused with everything else that I was doing.
So it was it the practice of meditating, where the goal in the meditation was to try to be as present as possible, that made you, did that then make you realize in other aspects of your life that you actually weren't being present?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I had a pretty similar experience as well. And it's not to say that I was really successful when doing my meditation. Actually, a lot of my meditations where the intention was to bring focus to, let's say, the breath, which it usually is, or you're doing something like a body scan. You know, I found it really hard sometimes to actually get into the meditation. And I think this relates to a lot of people when they get into it, especially for people who are maybe type A personality people. You know, they're hard chargers in life. They're people who like to be on the go all the time, which I know I am, and I think you are as well.
Yeah.
Those people typically tend to struggle with meditation because it forces you to sit still and pretty much do nothing and focus on, you know, just one simple thing. And, you know, I certainly know that often when I close my eyes, or even I try to think about one thing, my brain just goes on, you know, these crazy journeys and tangents about thinking about things that happened today, thinking about things that haven't happened, thinking about tomorrow, thinking about next week. But again, like you, the challenge of trying to be present in the moment made me then realize in other aspects of life, whether it was coaching a client, whether it was being in a meeting, you know, like now being in a podcast, how easy it was to get distracted was what I think one of the big things I've taken away from meditation.
I think going off that, when you're talking about getting distracted as well, is as you get better at the practice of being more present, you kind of remove the stigma or your opinion of how well that practice has gone, and being okay with accepting the days when you are more distracted or your mind is a little bit busier, and just thinking it as money in the bank, boxes ticked. I know that, like, for example, at the moment I'm doing it very regularly in the morning, and you know, there'll be some mornings where I'm really focused and I'll actually feel like I'll forget where I am. I won't realize that I'm in my living room. I'll think, you know, I'm just in my thoughts, I've forgotten, and 10 minutes goes by like that in a flash. And there'll be other mornings where thoughts will be running through my mind about, well, what are you doing for lunch today? What, you need to sort this out, you need to sort that out. And it's being aware of that your mind is busier at that stage, accepting that, and then potentially thinking about how you're going to then create action to appropriately manage that, rather than just being like, oh, my mind's busier, that's a terrible meditation, I've ruined the day, what was the point? So just not having any stigma attached to it, and just accepting that you've had a good day or you've had a bad day, much like in training. You know, if you have a bad day, not letting yourself get beaten up about it, just accepting that you had a bad day, cool.
It's about, I think, acknowledging that you've got a busy mind today.
Yeah, exactly.
And then the choice is then yours. You know, do we want to try and put in some mechanisms, some things in our day to try and quiet the mind? Or do we want to just kind of run with this and accept that the mind is busy and therefore have a really, really crazy productive day? Maybe this is the day to do things. And I think to not have, like you said, not have an outcome attached to what's happening right now, that choice is yours, essentially. Something that I've kind of, okay, running off that again now, is something that I found meditation to be really impactful for me, is that exactly what you're talking about there. I do find that if left to my own devices, and if I don't have a deliberate meditation practice in my day, my mind will just be constantly switched on all day. I know that I think about coaching and training and some form of something to do with health, wellness, and fitness. I know that my mind's wired to do that all day because I find it so fascinating. So even if I'm not training or not coaching someone, I'm observing someone, whether it's in my office, whether it's on the MTR, or it's on the street, and I'm like constantly analyzing and thinking about what they're doing and what their actions and their values, you know. And I think for me, deliberate meditation practice, it breaks up the day for me, because I find that sometimes overconsumption of just a mind that's always thinking is that, you know, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks out of mind doing that every single day, that's when I start to run into issues with my sleep. That's when I start to, you know, have dips and crashes in energy. That's where I start to get distracted from my work. And I know there's a knock-on effect of that constant stimulation. And as you said, in this day and age, there is stimulation around us all the time. And even easier in this day and age to get caught up about it, you know, get caught up in that stimulation. And you realize, you know, 16 hours from waking to nighttime, you haven't had a chance to switch off. And people used to say this shit to me all the time. You need to switch off. You need to get out of the gym. You need to stop just working all the time. You need to, you know. And I used to never see the validity or understand why people were saying it to me, because I was thinking, well, I'm working, I'm being productive, I'm moving the needle forward. How is that not a good thing? But obviously, what I was sacrificing by doing that was actually probably my mental and physical health a little bit, because you know we've only got a finite. Talked about this in the podcast many times, your finite resources every single day to put towards our work, our training, our thoughts, our relationships. And if your brain is just constantly switched on from waking to nighttime, you're just burning through those credits really, really fast. Yeah. And if you put on top of a really overactive mind, hard training sessions, life stress in other areas, that's where we start to, you know, that's where our buckets start to spill, we start to run into problems.
I think that's especially for one, the members that we see in the gym here, and with everyone, like everyone just leads such busy lives now. It's not, you know, it's not like we're working from 8 to 2 and then we're having the rest of the day off. People are going into the office really early, and you know, it's that kind of office culture of, you know, you can't leave until the manager leaves, or you know, if you're the first person to leave when the clock goes at 6 o'clock, it's a black mark on your schedule or whatever it is. That kind of attitude is present in so many workplaces, and people are working so hard in such high stress jobs. Like you say, it's so important to be able to have a practice or something that you can switch off. And for a lot of people, that is training, and that's great. But that also means, like we're talking about with the stress, that can be really damaging, or that can be really intense for a lot of people. If you're just hammering yourself and that's your switch off, is you putting more stress on your body, and then you're just going to bed, or you're taking pills to help you go to bed, you know, it's gonna be a vicious cycle.
Yeah, it's just a different type of stress, isn't it? I think we talk about that on the podcast all the time, is that whilst the stress may feel very different, we're talking about one thing here being like the stress of an overactive mind, and you're just talking about the physical stress of putting your body through a really hard workout. They may feel like two completely different things, but the way that the body receives it is essentially the same.
Yeah.
And overconsumption of that is where we start to run into issues long term. Nice. This idea of being present, let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah.
I remember I was asked to be a coach on a retreat, and it was like a really, it's the only retreat I've ever been a part of, truth be told. But you know, as the coach on this retreat, and it was a really amazing experience. And you know, they had one of their values when it came to doing a breakaway activity that maybe I'd be running. I'd be taking them through a training session or a coaching clinic about handstands, for example. One of the things they used to always say was like, you have to be deeply present. But at the time, the word present didn't have any meaning to me. So I didn't really know what being present was about. I hadn't kind of gone down that the rabbit hole that I've now gone down to understand what being present really means. So, because you brought the word up, what does being present mean to you? What is being present?
I think without trying to complicate it too much, it's just being aware of the situation you're in, what's going on around you right now. You know, not necessarily what's in your periphery, but it's what's straight ahead of you, what you're supposed to be focusing on, whether that's your handstand clinic, or whether that's this half hour block of revision you've got to do, or whether that's this personal training session, or whether that's this 5x5 back squat. You know, being aware of what you're doing right now, not letting other distractions creep into that, and just focusing on what you set out, what your intention was to do something, and trying to see that through, whether that's 10 minutes of mindfulness or breathing exercises or whatever it is.
How often in your day do you find or catch yourself not being present?
So on a lot of the Headspace end of the sessions that they have a bit more spiel in the last sort of minute and a half, and they talk about after the exercise that you've done or the work that you've done in that 10-15 minutes, think about implementing these things into your day. And I actually find it, I'm still learning, still very new to me, still trying to find that hard to implement it during the day. So it talks about, you know, if you're feeling stressed, think about focusing on your breath, 10 inhales, exhales. If you're feeling stressed or you're not feeling present, do a body scan for 2 minutes where you're just focusing from head to toe, trying to assess your emotions and your feeling at that exact point. And I'm not very good at that at the moment. I'm still, like I said, still learning the process, still trying to get better at it. But so I would say that I'm present, better at being present in the mindfulness that I do in the morning and in the evening. But throughout the day, I would actually say probably not that present.
90% of the time, I have no idea what you're saying then.
Yeah, so I think obviously you are present with what you're doing, but again, it's so easy to be distracted with everything that's around you. Like Hong Kong, there's so much stimulus. For me, being relatively new to the area, it's just lights everywhere, people everywhere, noise everywhere. So, and then the gym is a very busy place. There's a lot of stuff going on. It's not necessarily like the office is a no talking zone. There's lots of communication going on. So there, I wouldn't actually say that during the day there's that many times where I'm fully present. And that's a work on for me. That's something that I need to get better at.
I think there's also a difference between being kind of present
and fully present. Yeah.
Yeah, being present and then being like deeply present.
Yeah.
I think you'll find that sometimes when you're so deeply engaged in an activity or a conversation, it can almost be taxing and tiring in itself because you're just so
concentrated.
Yeah, you're so concentrated. I actually found, you know, when I first started getting into this podcast and was like interviewing guests, I found myself struggling being present because I was thinking about the next thing.
Yeah.
And it was a real challenge, you know, for men. I still kind of find myself doing it now, but you know, as an interviewer, you know, when I'm sitting down with someone else, there's a part of my brain that's thinking, I want this to be a good conversation for the people listening.
Yeah.
And the more you start to think about that, it's pulling you out of actually just being here in the moment, listening to what the person's saying, and just having a conversation, which is essentially what a podcast is, it's just a conversation. And I think people can probably pick up on times where I probably drifted out of a conversation and my head's gone towards the next question or the next conversation I want to get into, and I haven't actually listened and, you know, maybe responded appropriately to the person doing it. And I still catch myself doing that from time to time, from time to the podcast.
I think to bring that back to meditation as well, the moment you start thinking, oh God, I can't have these thoughts during meditation, that's when, you know, it's like, don't think of a pink elephant, what do you think of? So it's the same process where you're trying to just not have judgment with those thoughts and just be aware of them and let them pass, let them breeze through, rather than you thinking, oh no, I can't do this, I can't have that.
Well, I'm a bad person because I'm thinking about something else when I should be doing this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely do, just to say again, I do know the more and more I meditate, the better and better I am at catching myself in those situations where my objective is to be deeply present, that I'm able to catch myself quite quickly when I do drift off. Whereas I know before I started doing any form of meditation practice, I could probably be drifting off 15, 20 minutes before I kind of like shake my head and snap back into things again.
Yeah.
Okay, what does your meditation practice actually look like right now? What do you actually do? Is it something you do twice a day, you said?
Yeah, so whenever I have the time to be able to do it, it's usually when my bedtime routine is good, then I'll do it twice a day. If, you know, whatever situation, socializing or something's happened in the evening, I'm a little bit pushed to get into bed at a certain time to get my 8 hours, 8.5 hours, whatever, then I might skip the meditation. But usually on a good day, I'll make sure that it's after I've woken up and before I go to bed. So
Is that that as soon as you wake up?
No, so I allow myself to wake up a little bit. Otherwise, if I'm really tired, there have been times where I've actually started to drift off into sleep while I'm sat on the sofa or sat in a chair. So I try and make sure that, you know, I've showered, changed, got ready, started to get the coffee on the go or whatever, and then go and sit down, have my coffee in hand, haven't drunk it yet, do the meditation, and then my coffee is after I've had my meditation, so I'm not like stimulated through it. So that will look, at the moment, I just go through one course after another on Headspace, so they have things like letting go of stress or dealing with anxiety or food, or the actual 10 minutes of meditation is very similar on any of these courses, but just like the spiel that they'll give at the start or at the end that will relate it back to whatever it is that you're trying to work on, will kind of link in with the meditation practice that you've done, where you're being more present in making food choices, or you're being more present when you're feeling stressed, or you're being more present when you're feeling anxiety about something, and you're being aware of those emotions that are at that time, and then just not putting judgment on them and just accepting them. So that'll be like 10 minutes in the morning, 10-15 minutes in the morning, and then the meditation in the evening is right at bedtime. So I've journaled, I've read, lights off, Headspace for 10 minutes, which will be like a sleep breathing, and that will be focusing on the breath, like 5 seconds in, five seconds out, and then it'll be kind of making a small recap on the day that I've had, like 20-30 moments touch on your day, and it kind of rounds the day off nicely, and then it allows you to try and switch off from your toe up to your head, one body part at a time, bringing you down to be more relaxed, focusing on your breathing still. And then a lot of the times, if I'm tired, by the end of that 10 minutes, I fall asleep before I even do anything else, before I turn the phone off or anything like that. But sometimes it'll take the 10 minutes of me doing that meditation, and then I'll need to turn the light off.
Do you notice any difference in your day if you, let's say, skip that morning meditation?
I think in general, half of it's definitely the meditation practice for sure, just being a little bit calmer, less emotionally sort of dragged towards one situation or another. But also, it's kind of like, you know, like if you do your rehab, or you do the thing that you set out that you wanted to do in the day, ticking that box, you get a rough rush of endorphins from that. And I think half of it is that, it's like, it was good that I put that time aside for me to do that. Well done me, gold star. And then the other half of that is actually that it made me feel calmer, more present, more relaxed. And I wake up from it out of the meditation, and it says, "How, be aware of how you're feeling right now." And you're like, yeah, that was actually really good. Like, I do feel good. I do feel ready for the day. So it does make an impact on my day for sure.
Do you feel, when you have a really good meditation, when you're deeply present, really focused, do you get an energy kick afterwards?
Yeah, 100%. It's like you're in a flow state, and I'll forget that I'm sitting on my sofa with the lights on in the living room for the 10 minutes that I was there. Open my eyes up, and my eyes are hazy, and I was like,
kind of have to wake
yourself up. Yeah, it's like what we've talked about in the past, about you're almost falling into that sleep state without actually going to sleep. And there's new research, or there's some research on that being really beneficial, similar to like biophasic sleeps or naps and things like that. So just when you do go through that, you're like, wow, I was actually really in the zone there. That's awesome. And it kind of shows you that it's almost worthwhile, that what you're doing, you're getting better at that practice. Whereas when you first start, and if you have a period where you've stopped doing that habit for a couple of weeks, and then you come back to it, your mind is crazy and you can't focus and your legs are twitching and all that sort of stuff. Like, I'm a pretty energetic person, so there'll be times where it's hard for me to actually relax and switch off. My mind will be going all over the place, but when my mind does switch off, I know that practice is working for me.
Yeah, I know Andrew Huberman, who I've talked about on this podcast before, yeah, we've had a conversation as well, he refers to it as non-sleep induced rest, and like a really good meditation practice, anything between 5 to, you know, 15-20 minutes, actually, research, as you said, is actually having a very similar impact to what a nap does in recharging, you know, a lot of the hormonal system, but kind of giving your body that physical, mental reboot to just kind of kick on with the day again.
Yeah.
so something I've been playing around recently. So obviously I was a big part of the Headspace journey. It was probably what got me into meditation in the first place. And it kind of got to a point where I kind of stopped wanting to be so reliant on it. I think a big part as well for me is that meditation for me is something I typically do at nighttime. So it's kind of like you, it's a closing out of my day. So, you know, typically have quite an active mind and an active body during the day. And then for me, a part of my nighttime routine, roughly about 7:30, 8 o'clock, and I want to start to switch off. And so kind of that starts with kind of switching lights off the living room. I actually usually do this on a shakti mat now, you know, one of those spiky things. And that, I love that because it forces me to, I can't move on it because it fucking hurts when you move. So you actually have to be completely still on it. And I kind of elevate my legs as well. I just find it's a comfortable position. And I know I'm kind of flushing out some lymph from my legs as well. And then basically I started to not want to do Headspace because it was forcing me to be on my phone to do it.
Yeah.
And so I played around with, you know, having headphones in, but then I still had to be on the phone, which meant one of my things with my nighttime routine was to not be on my phone, but to use a Headspace, I had to be on my phone. So basically I ended the Headspace journey, stopped doing it, went through a bit of time where I tried to just navigate and basically run my own sessions, where essentially I kind of have Andy's voice in the back of my head, because I've listened to him so many times, Andy taking me through a 5 to 10 minute meditation, I'd basically take myself through it. But I found it just wasn't quite the same. It meant that I had to think about what to think about, and that wasn't actually helping me switch off. So, you know, then going off, you know, through a bit of exploration with breath work, and, you know, reading, and we've done some podcasts on that as well, but then started to really use breath as my guiding, as my way to guide me through the meditation. And sometimes it's just as simple as counting the number of breaths that I'm doing.
Yeah.
Trying to hold a specific breath cadence. Usually for me, that's kind of like a 5 second inhale through the nose and a 5 second exhale through the nose, or sometimes through the mouth. And I'm just trying to count those seconds as I'm doing it. And I'm also trying to count my breaths. And so something I like to use as almost as a testing metric to see how present I'm being is seeing how long I can rack up numbers in my counting with my breath. So it will be like 1, 2, and in a really deep loop, in a practice where I'm really focused and present, I could get up to 50, 100, 200, and there's times like last night I can't make it past 10. And it's funny because when you're going through the process, you don't realize you've lost count of the numbers until 5 seconds goes by and you realize you've stopped counting altogether.
You think about chicken.
Yeah, exactly. And you realise that, oh shit, I forgot what I was even doing. So then I'll just kind of bring it back to 1 again and then start counting up again. And so I think for me, that's kind of where my meditation practice has gone now. Something I've started to experiment with is yoga nidra, which again is something I took from Andrew Huberman. And if you guys don't know who Andrew Huberman is, check out his podcast. It's really, really good. Very, very deep on the science stuff, but he explains it really well in kind of layman's terms.
Got good Instagram as well.
Yeah, really good. And his Instagram's great. He puts out loads of educational content.
Yeah.
He talks about yoga nidra, and yoga nidra is essentially nothing really to do with what I would think yoga to be. It's a meditation practice where you're basically doing a body scan, starting with your toes and kind of switching off your muscles the way to your head, and then kind of just some nice chill music in the background, which actually most a lot of time almost sends me into like a bit of a like a hypnosis, where kind of like I'm so into the yoga nidra that time, like you said, just disappears, and you kind of just wake up and you're like, wow, where did time go?
Yeah.
Have you played around with any of the hypnosis stuff?
So I actually went through a stage of hypnosis therapy for a period of time, for about maybe like 10 or 15 sessions, and at that time I was also practicing Headspace, doing lots of mindfulness, and it kind of went hand in hand. And again, like you, exactly how you said, you know, I might be under or going through this exercise for 30 minutes, and it's hard to tell whether you've fallen asleep or whether you just switched off. But she'd be like, Patrick, it's time for you to wake up. And this was all over Zoom because it was height of COVID last year, and I was like, sorry, did I fall asleep? I was expecting to have snored over Zoom or whatever. But yeah, like you say, that being able to fall into that state where you, and how I talked about before, where you forget where you are for those minutes, and then you come out of it and you're like, oh, what was I doing? Like, it would have been nice to have been a fly on the wall to see what was going on.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting.
Yeah, I did a, I went to Phuket and I was, I did a meditation class. So I was in this room with five others, basically like a yoga studio, and the teacher came in and there's an hour's class. And I was obviously thinking, like, what can we do for an hour? Mm. Surely we're not just going to sit in a, in a silent room for an hour. But essentially that's what we did. You know, he kind of brought some focus to the room and the environment and the surroundings, and we started by, you know, dialing in our sight. He didn't let us close our eyes or lie down, which was
the whole thing.
The whole thing, yeah. Wow. So he, you know, basically I said to him, I quite like lying down when I do it, and he said, well, you know, often that might lead to induced sleep, and that's not what we're trying to do in a meditation practice. Like, we want to actually remain present and somewhat aware of what we're doing in the moment of time. So, okay. So first sitting cross-legged for me is really, really uncomfortable. We just don't have the mobs to get into the position. So, so I was, I basically had like seven pillows propped under my ass where everyone else was like sat perfectly cross-legged on the floor.
Yeah.
And then like my back was like on fire, because actually was just like, I was sat like a shitting dog basically for an hour. And it was at first really, really uncomfortable. And you know, a lot of it at the start was guided, he was taking us to a breath, and then it just went silent. And admittedly, I found it quite hard when it went silent, because I was just kind of looking around the room, almost being like, am I the only one not in a trance right now? Everyone else looks so calm and peaceful, and like, and even the teacher's just, he had his eyes open and looking straight at me. But like, he was looking through me, it's like I wasn't really there.
Yeah.
So, you know, I really tried to focus in, and eventually, yeah, so I don't know what happened, but it was the end of class. And you know, he was like, and I looked at the clock and I was like, wow, 45 minutes just disappeared, and I have no idea if I was awake or asleep.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a pretty crazy experience. He really went into like the questioning of whether we were even here on Earth.
Wow.
And whether we were aliens or if there's aliens around us. Yeah, he was like on a whole
12th dimension stuff.
Yeah, it was pretty interesting though. I would like to talk about the role of meditation in with regards to the parasympathetic system, the sympathetic system, and then relate that back to training, because I think a lot of, you know, a lot of people here and people who are actively investing in training probably on a daily or weekly basis.
Yeah.
And so I'll kick it off. I think, you know, it's important to understand that, you know, we talk about stress all the time. You've used the word stress already in this podcast, but essentially, you know, anything that puts us into a state of excitement, or whenever that adrenaline starts to kind of get excreted from the body, so we're excited about something, we're happy, we're nervous, we're upset, that general increase in tissue temperature, the increase in heart rate. And we talk about the importance of, you know, if we're going to have a moment where the sympathetic system is driven and is driving up, it's important to bring ourselves back out of it. And that's exactly why we do a cool down.
Yeah.
You know, we talk about warm ups and cool downs all the time in training, but I think we forget the importance of the cool down. I would say, as a training population of people, we're pretty good at warming up, we're really good at doing the session, and we're really, really bad at cooling down. So what we typically do is the session finishes and we just simply move on out of the gym onto the next task of the day.
Yeah.
So if we can understand what's happening there, is that in the training session itself, we are moving our nervous system into a sympathetic state. You know, we're highly aware of the weight we're about to lift, the load we're about to put in our back, bracing the tension, or the pushing hard to finish a workout against the clock, which essentially is a stressor on the body, right? We're deliberately inducing stress on the body in the hope that we'll adapt to that stress and become fitter, faster, stronger, whatever, fill in the blank. And then what we do is that we finish the workout, and what do? We run to the shower, we then run to our meal, we slam food down our throat, and we're still actually in that stress state. Right, heart rate still elevated, body hasn't calmed down yet. And then we run to the office, we go to the office and we start to get straight into work, or we get into a meeting, and then it's just more stress. And then, you know, this is where kind of exercise ends up being a contributor to stress human beings who aren't able to bring themselves out of it. And so meditation for me also has taught me to how to control myself in a high stress environment and bring myself back down into a parasympathetic state. So in the training scenario, is after a really hard training session, to try to deliberately focus on bringing myself back down to a resting state. So I'll use things like my heart rate as a really general indicator, which the cool thing about the Apple Watch is I have it on here, and I will go through some form of almost like a meditation practice where I'm just kind of sitting or I'm lying down and focusing on my breath, and I'm trying to bring my heart rate back down to resting. And the moment I kind of get there and I feel like I'm back at homeostasis, I can crack on with my day and move on to the next thing. So it's kind of deliberately just putting in that little break between the stresses of my day, because I know that those little breaks between stresses is going to allow me to finish my day in a much healthier place versus constant exposure to stress.
And that's something that we've talked about casually before as well. So what we like to do as a group is train together at 10 o'clock all the way through to about 12, half 12, and then we try and get outside. Hopefully the weather's good enough for us to get some vitamin D, chill out, have a chat, eat some food, take on a protein shake, and then we go back into the office. And we like to do that collectively as coaches. It's like more of a bonding situation as well, but it's also, like you say, relaxes us, get some vitamin D at the same time, and then you're ready to go back, go through your programming, go through your meetings, whatever it is that you need to do for the rest of the day.
Yeah, and it's sometimes based on how hard and intense a training session is will dictate what the group does in that 20 minutes a day session. So I know on Tuesday we had a really hard aerobic session. We did aerobic Tuesdays and all basically completely butchered the pacing, and we're all very tired at the end of it.
Yeah.
And so whereas today, where we kind of did more of a strength based session, felt a little bit fresher at the end, maybe not yourself, Paddy. Most people felt relatively fresh. Kind of, we went outside and were able to just kind of have a conversation, eat our lunch straight away. Everyone's in fairly good spirits. Whereas Tuesday, really hard training session, everyone feeling pretty depleted at the end. The outdoor session that we had was minimal conversation. Everyone was basically lying on their backs, headphones in, and just like going through their own breathing drills. And it was cool to actually see, because I'm quite observing this kind of stuff, that it wasn't a conversation where we all said, all right, guys, I get headphones in, go through your meditation. It was that the team took themselves through that process, knowing that what they'd just done was a pretty hard, taxing task. They still had lots of tasks to do in the day, work-related, that they wanted to be on form for. So therefore, okay, I'm going to use this opportunity, rather just to socialize and chat, to actually focus on bringing myself back out of that sympathetic state and bring myself back into a state where I can actually crack on.
I think it's important to link that back to that. You could argue that that definitely is a form of meditation or a form of mindfulness, is you just being present in the moment, focusing on breathing, focusing on relaxing, and just not letting Instagram dictate what you're doing, just sitting down, enjoying the sun, eyes closed, eyes open, whatever it is, just being sat down, present in that moment, rather than letting anything else pull you away from it, and that's going to bring down that stress state.
Yeah, and I think, you know, for someone who doesn't train, or you have other situations in your life where you do find yourself in that heightened state, and a lot of us deal with it with work on a constant basis. I mean, even as coaches, like the energy we probably get from coaching a group class is like, you know, heart rate spikes, energy spikes, and you sometimes finish coaching a couple of group classes and you feel like very depleted and exhausted.
Rude.
Yeah, and I think it's important that, you know, that's again where meditation come into it. Not only using perhaps a meditation practice and putting it into that to break up and bring yourself back out of that stress state, but also to be able to better take yourself, to be able to be faster in transitioning between high stress and low stress.
Yeah.
I think that's another skill as well. You know, for me, certainly, having a meditation practice at the end of every single day is essentially going from busy, 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 busy day to now try to switch off and unwind. And I've gotten better over the years at being able to flip the switch and get straight into a good meditation practice, and then, you know, essentially 20 minutes later be ready to sleep. Now, again, there's a skill that's been cultivated there just by repetition of practicing meditation and practicing that switching off, and I can now apply that to other aspects of my day. So if a non-forecasted situation suddenly pops up, and, you know, I don't know, a fire takes place in the gym, probably a terrible example, but I'm able to now bring myself from that heightened state. Now, here's a better example. I'm getting fucking scared every time I walk out of the toilet at the moment with people on their telephones. I'm able to go from a resting heart rate to a max heart rate, back down to relatively resting heart rate pretty quickly, and I really do contribute a lot of that to, you know, just a practice of you know, meditation.
Yeah.
All right, let's wrap this up, Paddy. If someone was to listen to this episode and start to think about perhaps implementing meditation into their daily rituals, or to start to experiment with it, where would you start? Where would you recommend someone begins?
If you didn't want to spend any money whatsoever, one, there's free trials. Sam Harris has an app called Waking Up.
Yeah,
and you can actually, if you don't, I think the subscription's selling pretty cheap, like 14 quid a month or something. But he actually has something that says if you can't pay it, you can email us and we will grant 100% of those applications to have a free membership. Because he just wants to spread the message of mindfulness and meditation, which is really cool. Headspace, you can pay like
$70 a month.
Yeah, it's like 30-40 quid. Yeah, I don't know. On UK times.
Yeah.
It's like 35 quid for a year, and that gives you unlimited access to everything. And if you didn't want to spend any money, you could go on YouTube, and I'm sure there'll be some good guided meditations. Like hypnosis meditations and mindful, all sorts of, so many different practices and variations of meditation you can go through. But what I would advise is for you to do some form of guided meditation to start off with, just because it's a minefield of thoughts. And like we said, the moment you start that practice, your mind will go anywhere but where you want it to be focused on. So having someone to bring your focus into that, whether that's through a body scan, whether that's through switching body parts off, whether that's through a visualization or breathing or whatever it is, that's a really good way of you getting more present in that situation. So I would advise downloading an app, paying a little bit of money if you can, or going through some form of guided meditation first.
Yeah.
And then if you want to do, like you have done, broken off from your own later on, you can. I'm not at that stage yet where I feel competent enough to do that, so.
Yeah, I think something else to add on top of that, we talk about this in training all the time, minimum recoverable volume. Start by doing little and building volume as you go along.
Yeah, don't try and do half an
hour. I think it's natural, right? And I think what was cool about Headspace is it gives you the option in your meditations, how long you want meditation to last. You can choose 5 minutes up to 30 minutes, I think. And I think, you know, if this is new to you and you're starting out, start with 5 minutes, that's enough. Or something else just popped into my head. Another form of meditation I use, if you have an Apple Watch, they have the Breathe app, which is really, really good. The Breathe app is, you all have it on your Apple Watches. Basically, it vibrates, it makes your wrist vibrate. You can choose it from 1 to 5 minutes. The watch will vibrate when it tells you to inhale, or vibrate when it tells you to exhale. And it's working on about a 4 second inhale with a 2 to 3 second retention, and then a 4 second exhale with 2 to 3 retention, which is kind of like a variation of box breathing.
Yeah.
So sometimes I will actually use that to help guide me through and hold me accountable, keep me to a breathing rhythm. That's really good.
Garmin's actually have the same.
Garmin has as well. Yeah. Nice. Yeah, so start short. Be successful. You talked about atomic habits, we need to talk about habit stacking. Talk us through that, because I think one place a lot of people struggle with is knowing when to meditate and how to create the routine and habit of getting into meditation until it gets to the point where it's a part of the day.
Yeah, so something really simple was just completely ripping off atomic habits is habit stacking. So stacking a habit that you want to achieve on top of something that you already do very regularly, subconsciously. For example, cleaning their teeth in the morning. There are very few people that don't clean their teeth in the morning. Whether that's when you first wake up in the morning, whether that's just before you leave, or say for example, for me, without fail, pretty much every morning I make a coffee. So the moment I finish making my coffee and it's in my cup, I then walk over to the sofa, the coffee's parked on the side and I don't drink it until I finish my meditation. And it's kind of like almost like my small reward for hitting it as well. So. Stack something that you already do, whether that's making your bed, getting dressed. The moment you've decided on that one task that you do subconsciously, put a habit on top of that, like mindfulness, 5 minutes of breathing, 10 minutes of breathing, whatever it is, on top of something you already do, and you'll find it a lot easier to stack those habits and fix that habit in your subconscious mind.
Nice. Okay, Paddy, we'll wrap that up there. Nice. Folks, if you are on your own meditation journeys, whether you're being successful or in your eyes you think you're beyond successful, we'd love to hear about your story. If you're thinking about getting into this for the very first time, please do reach out to us. Myself and Paddy both love to share kind of more of our thoughts, more of our journeys, and hopefully some tips on how you can kind of get into it. But I think on behalf of both of us, we really do vouch for the importance and the validity in it. As you said, there's just so many people now who just vouch the benefits of meditation and, you know, have used it to their advantage. And whether it's sport, whether it's business, whether it's life and relationships, whether it's their own personal well-being, yeah, just so many benefits of it. Paddy, I hope you enjoyed popping your podcast cherry.
Thank you very much.
You were a fantastic guest, and thank you for sharing your story.
Thanks for having me.
Where can people find out more about Patrick James, the coach?
Patrick_James_coach on Instagram. That's the only platform you ever need.
And what are they going to find when they stumble across your profile?
They're going to find high quality content. That's that.
All right, Paige, well, I hope you enjoyed the episode. Have a fantastic day.
My ears hurt.
Yeah, it squeezes your head.